Okay, I'd like to say hello to everybody. If you guys would take your seats, please, we can get started. Would ask Kathy's question if there's anybody new to the meeting, but oops, that's me. Hi. For those of you that I have not met personally, my name is Kobe Shaw. I've been recently hired as executive director for Tortoise Group. I was here last meeting and I met with some of you individually. Hi, I'm the new guy. Who else is new here? Awesome, that's wonderful. I would like to, at some point, you folks that are new, I'd like to hear about how you heard about Tortoise Group. And we can talk about that individually, but I'm very interested to know how we're reaching out to the community, because we definitely need to reach out to the community and get folks involved just as you are. How many Tortoise Group members do we have out there? Awesome. How many lifetime members we got? Right on. Okay, so I don't know if you guys know this or not, but until December 31st, you got a special deal going on for lifetime membership. Lifetime membership right now is $500, and that ends on December 31st. On January 1st, it jumps up to $750. So if you were thinking about being a lifetime member, exploding offer, now is the time. But seriously, think about being a lifetime member if you thought about it, because that is going up on January 1st. Are there any people in the audience looking to adopt a tortoise? Anybody thinking about adopting a tortoise? Excellent. Then you are sitting right next to the person you need to talk to, Sarah. That's absolutely perfect. So those of you that that knew Janina from before and weren't here at the last meeting, Janina has moved on to greener pastures job-wise. She's working for a company out in Boulder City. Sarah has taken Janina's spot. Sarah, you wave hi to everybody. So obviously, we have literally hundreds of tortoises looking for homes, hatchlings and tortoises. So one of the things we need to do is spread the word about a need for adoptions. We need people to adopt tortoises. Separate breeding pair. Does anybody have any questions about that? Everybody knows the importance of separating breeding pair, right? I'm going to assume, unless somebody has a question. We already covered that. All right, so the Golden Tortoise Society, that is something that one of our board members started, Dominique, and what it is basically is, I don't want to call it an insurance policy for your tortoise, but odds are that your tortoise is going to outlive you. So that we offer a program, which is essentially annuities, trust, however you want to look at it, but we have a program that allows you to care for your tortoise after you have gone. So if you have any questions about that, you can see me later.
No, that's what I was going
to
ask. Can your trust, can our living trust?
Yes. Yes, ma'am. Because that we get into lots of details, and that's why better conversation have one-on-one. Okay. Have you guys all had a chance? This is a better question to ask. Who here has not been to the Tortoise Group website within the last month? So you guys are okay. I would encourage everybody to look at the website. It is a brand new website. It's a lot easier to navigate. Again, Dominique, one of our board members, put tons and tons of time making sure that it's operational. So please take a look at that. I say this because it offers a lot of, I don't want to call them widgets because that's not the right word, but the ability to rehome tortoises, the lost and found. So now we are looking to become, I don't want to say the Craigslist, but we need to be the home of tortoises and tortoise information in Southern Nevada. If somebody loses a tortoise, they should be able to put their information online. And if somebody has found a tortoise, they should be able to post that information where anybody else can look at it. That's the intent behind it, and it's working quite well. We've rehomed, what, four or five over the past month? I know there's been several, and it's working. So it's on there. Hope you never lose your tortoise, but if you do, know that feature is on there. Okay. So we need volunteers. This is news to anybody? We have awesome volunteers. It's news to you guys, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
We just got our tortoise a few months ago.
Over the summer.
You got it over the summer?
Yes.
Okay. What's your tortoise's name?
Mine's name is Owen, and his
tortoise's
name is Terrence.
Owen and Terrence?
Yes.
Are they like old men with canes? What? How come, why not Terry? Why Terrence?
Because, well, Terrence kind of, my favorite YouTuber, he kind of named his pig Terrence. And I'm like, hey, that sounds like a good name for a tortoise.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, welcome to Tortoise Group. There are plenty of people here that can answer you guys' questions about tortoises, okay? And specifically, Sarah in the back that we pointed out, Kathy up here, our board chair, and myself. So when you guys at Tortoise, we'll break for snacks and whatnot, and then we can ask specific questions about Owen and Terrence, okay? Okay. Volunteers. Tortoise Group is an awesome organization that has existed. It has existed formally since 1982 because of volunteers. We need volunteers all the time. We have a broad array of things that volunteers can do. Like in the back, we've got Trilla and Marjorie and Kat. Hi, guys. And they're volunteers. And dude, I don't know your name. What's your name?
Scott.
Scott. Scott. Is filming this. All this is happening because of volunteers. We need volunteers right now. If you guys are interested in volunteering for Tortoise Group, please let me know. Please let Kathy know. Specifically, we have two needs. I don't know if you guys know this or not, but Tortoise Group actually goes up to the women's prison. There is a tortoise habitat inside the women's prison, and there are three tortoises up there? Three tortoises. We need women volunteers. Now, That is an obligation, and it's something that if you're only going to be in town for the next 6 months to a year, it's probably not the thing for you because there's training to go through it's the Department of Corrections, and it's a long-term thing. It's nothing bad. They just want to make sure that you're going to be in it for the long haul. We need volunteers for that. We also need volunteers for our audit.
We're a
volunteer, right? Yeah, we got anybody that does financial stuff, come see me. If you're interested in doing that. All right. JC, if you would give me the next slide, please. Oh, I do. Right on. Okay. We have an event coming up, and that is okay, Tino the Tortoise. Carolyn Ahern is a author and also a member of Tortoise Group. She'll be doing a book reading in Barnes & Noble in Henderson. You guys have all the information up there. And obviously the information is on our website as well. Good stuff, go to it, Airborne. Questions about this?
Is that next Friday?
Yes, it's the 24th. So that would be Saturday. The 23rd is Friday, 24th Saturday. Okay, plant sale going on next, that one's two Saturdays from now. And then there's also a plant sale. You guys can look at all that. I'm not gonna read all that information to you. If you have questions about it, you ask me.
There, it's a great deal.
What's that?
It's a great deal, and you can get actual tortoise plants there for $5.
Yes, everybody hear that? Kathy said that this is a great deal, and you can buy tortoise plants there for very cheap, for $5. There's also a standard flower show that's being put on by the Nevada Garden Club, and that goes next Saturday, November 7th. And there's information online if you go to the Nevada Garden Club. Okay. Awesome. Okay, so I'm sorry, do we have a question?
I see him going in, but did he come back out?
It's supposed to be the end of the presentation.
That was rude of me, showing a tortoise's back end before it's over. Apologies. Okay.
I'm assuming Todd is not here.
He is.
Oh. Todd, hello.
Hi.
I would like to welcome Todd Esque from the United States Geological Survey, and he's going to give a talk on tortoises in winter.
Not now, though.
Not now?
No.
Okay.
I do.
Not yet. She'll be coming back. Okay, my turn.
Kathy.
Thank you, Kobe. Just throw him in here and he does a pretty darn good job, doesn't he? He's really a good guy and you're going to enjoy working with him. So let's give Kobe a big hand. Okay, now I want to, wow, it's got a little feedback, huh? A little more. Is that better? Oop, now I'm gone. Oh well. Now we're at the question and answers point. Let's go back. Or tortoise tales, if you want to tell some tales. So who's got a question? Wow, nobody. Yes. Owen. What about Owen?
Well, when do tortoises mainly go into hibernation?
I'm going to talk about that in just a little bit. After we have some other kinds of questions, I'm going to talk all about brumation. So, hang on, and if I don't answer your question, please ask me, because we'll be talking about that. Yes, Derek.
So, we've noticed our tortoise likes to do its business inside of its burrow.
Isn't that adorable?
Other than just getting in there and scraping it out, do they do that in the wild? Is that healthy to leave it there, or should you clean it out on what kind of regular basis?
Let's see, I just dug up my burrow after 15 years, and there it was. All the stuff of 15 years, and the cockroaches and the black widow spiders, and they're all getting along in there fine. And it was all clean and beautiful, and I looked down there the other day, and here's this giant black big poop kind of across the back, and I thought, oh well, we're starting a new batch. So I would just leave it there. I know it's not what we're used to, but it's what tortoises do.
That I was more concerned about. So I'm assuming it's natural, but I
want to... It is. Crickets and cockroaches and everybody else in there. And it doesn't draw ants for some reason. Why is that, Todd?
Seeds, maybe.
The seeds. Well, it doesn't seem to make for a mess, and the tortoises don't mind. You know, they're a little bit caked with poop on the bottom shell sometimes, and they don't mind. Anyone else? Yes.
How often do they eat?
Just as often as they can. It's a little bit tricky, and... during the middle of the season, we usually feed our tortoises a little every day or every couple of days and then have a lot of plants for them to browse on. So they like to be eating all the time, and pretty much if you give them food, they'll eat it. All of it. This much, this much, this much, you know, they eat a ton. These lads have a lot of questions. Yes?
When we feed our tortoises, if they don't eat it, because what if we give it to them, within a 15-minute
radius,
they won't eat it, and then once we walk away
for
15 minutes and come back, they're just starting to eat it. Is that normal?
Usually what you want to do when you're feeding a tortoise, especially now, in the summer they're all warmed up and ready to eat right when you see them. But now, your tortoise is going to need to come out and bask for quite a while. Hang on now. I'll get to you, okay? The tortoise is going to need to bask to warm up to about 85 degrees before it's going to start eating. So right now, my tortoise came out. It was like night and day, right? During the week it was hot, and then yesterday, all of a sudden we're into fall. So my tortoise is out there this morning, this rock, you know, completely different from the tortoise of a few days ago. And he was warming up. So he needs to warm up. And when he starts warming up and then he starts walking around and being interested in things, that's when you want to feed your tortoise. You don't want to race out there and put food in front of the burrow or food in front of them just because they happen to be there. And then if they don't eat it, pick it up, because then otherwise the ants will be on it. Yes?
Well, My tortoise, it is hungry a lot, but never bites anyone. But his tortoise
a lot of the time, he snaps our fingers, then he bites it. Is that normal?
Well, do you think he's biting your finger because your finger happens to be in the way? Because
no, he walks towards my finger.
Well, here's the way tortoises eat. And it's interesting that you think the tortoise is biting you because it's really not. So you're holding something, right? And it goes. Now, was it biting your finger or was it just trying to bite the dandelion or the flower or whatever you had?
Because I have big grass.
Well, what are you holding for it to eat?
Nothing.
Well, what are you doing?
I'm just laying my hands on it and he walks towards my finger.
It must smell really yummy. Well, tortoises never bite. They're never aggressive, and they never go to bite you. So your fingers are getting in their way. And so you just, well, maybe you have fragrant skin or something. For instance, they love to go after women's toenails if they're painted red because they think they're flowers. And you just have to watch out and move your darn feet, otherwise you'll get bitten. Now, they're not biting you in anger, and your tortoise isn't doing that either. Any other questions about behavior, or we're going to talk all about brumation. More than you ever wanted to know about brumation. Yes?
My brother, he sometimes wakes up their tortoises when they're sleeping. Is that kind of unhealthy for them?
Waking up tortoises when they're sleeping? Well, where are they?
Well, we have them inside.
Oh, did you guys hear that? No.
For night.
Okay, we'll want to talk to you a little bit later about that because tortoises must live outside. And then that opportunity to wake them up and play with them and mess with them isn't there because they regulate their own times and so on.
Well, we're afraid of something.
That's well, we can all these people have tortoises. And these teeny weeny weeny little ones over there that are only that big can be protected, and yours can too. So we'll show you how to do that. Anything else? Okay, JC, let's go on to the next one. So, I want to talk about fall behavior, and look what happened. All of a sudden it got cold and rainy, and this was yesterday at my house. I decided to put the tarp out because I was expecting all this rain. Of course, when it rained an inch a couple of weeks ago, I didn't have it out. So, but it's been raining and raining. It's been lovely, hasn't it? And Tad's out looking around. Yeah, please come on in, you two. And you can see that the globe mallow here, actually this morning it has a little blossom on it somewhere, but it's looking pretty fallish outside now. So there's a lot of dried stuff for tortoises to eat. And things have changed radically since earlier in the week. We'll talk about it. So what's changed? We still have hatchlings coming out. And there are two of them over there that are just as adorable as they can be. They started appearing on August 15th. We got our first call about an emergence of hatchlings. Remember that they live all on their own, boys, all by themselves outside in the desert. It's not easy. They might get eaten up, but that's where they have to live. And they're okay. They may not eat as much as you think they should if you have hatchlings, but they're really okay until spring. But now we've had cooler temperatures and rain just out of the blue, haven't we? So does anybody have a tortoise that's actually in brumation yet? That's just amazing, because normally by this time we would have tortoises in brumation. So who has a tortoise that's normally in brumation by this time? Oh, uh-huh, and so they're not. Very interesting. So, won't it be interesting to see what happens this week? As we know, as fall proceeds, the tortoise normally basks more and more because the weather's cooler, and then they start coming out less and less often until finally they're not there anymore, and they eat less also. Now, how about the eating? Has that changed? So even though it was hot, the tortoises really cut way down on their eating, didn't they? Just like the trees, there's a hormonal change that's going on in them, and they're getting ready even though it's warm outside. Now, why do tortoises brumate? Well, I went through these things last month, but I'm going to go through them again kind of quickly this time, and I know we have some new people, and I hope you won't be too bored by the repetition of this. It's their adaptation to the cold. They can't survive out there when it's 30 degrees or 40 degrees because they can't warm up enough. They have to get up to 85 to do tortoise stuff, so they chill out. And that's what brumation is. They have this strategy that's pretty clever. Well, I can't be out there, so I'll just get cold and stay there until it gets warm enough again. Sulcatas and leopard tortoises that come from warmer climates don't brumate. So if you have one of those, you have to create a different kind of a habitat, one that has something to keep them warm all winter. So the definition of brumation is it's winter dormancy in cold-blooded animals with backbones like reptiles and amphibians. And as we just noticed, this change is independent of the temperature. So even though it was hot, the tortoises were changing anyway. Todd, do we know yet why that really is? We don't. The change in the sun, who knows? It's a mystery. The tortoises know, but they haven't told us. So what happens is they go into their burrows. Their metabolism goes way down. Their heart rate goes way down. Their breathing goes way down. And they're just going to sleep through the winter. And then it's all the reverse in the spring. Now, over the winter, the tortoise is going to lose some water from breathing. And so you want your tortoise to be all pumped up before it goes into brumation. So you want to feed it, but as we know now, it's already telling us that it doesn't want as much food. So we need to listen to that. Just don't bother feeding it as often. And I've noticed I put out this food and Tad just eats a little and then he walks in it. It's really adorable. He's done and then he walks right through it. It makes me so mad. Whereas normally all year long, he just mows through whatever I put out for him, but not now. So just browsing would be enough. If you have stuff in your yard for them to browse on, that would be sufficient for your tortoise, probably at this time of year. Especially as they start going in and out, if your tortoise is only coming out maybe twice a week, this is going to happen pretty soon, then just don't feed it. Just let it do its own thing, and pretty soon it'll be gone. You want to make sure it's pumped up with plenty of water, so you want to soak it. Maybe your tortoise goes into water, but mine doesn't. And so I have to keep putting him in there, and then he just gets right out. And your tortoise should feel like a real heavy melon, like a cantaloupe or a watermelon that's really plump. Yeah, bonk, 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 you know. If it feels kind of light, it isn't hydrated enough. And then it's going to be a little tougher to get through the winter. Well, there's Tad. I put him in there, and he stayed about, you know, a minute and a half, and then he was ready to get out. He said, enough of that. He has a pond, too, that he never goes in. So within the natural range, The same questions come up. When's the tortoise going to hibernate? How long and where? So they each have their own schedule. I have a little chart that I've made over the years of when my tortoise goes into brumation and when it comes out and how much it weighs. And it's kind of fun because, surprisingly, I don't remember all that well. And it always seems to me it's such and such a date, and then I look back and find out it was actually a little bit different date. So it's really fun to keep that schedule because it used to be, until last year at least, when our weather got so crazy, that the tortoise would come in and out within about a week or a week and a half of the same time. Some tortoises actually go into brumation in September, some not until Thanksgiving. So there's quite a span there, and the same in spring for the emergence. Your tortoise will decide. And it's really fun to just watch it and be looking for that last day. Sad, though. Now, where should the tortoise brumate? I hear all the time about tortoises that are under the bed and in the closet. And so they've actually survived, and we know that because people are talking about it. But those tortoises are losing water when they're inside because their metabolism isn't going to be cold, is it? It's going to be much warmer than it would be outside. It should be between 35 and 50 outside, and inside it's going to be, what, 70. So the body's using up its resources when it should be chilling out. Maybe Todd can tell us what goes on in there in those tortoises. Are you going to do that?
A little bit.
Good, good. I've been dying to know. So it should be in a well-insulated, snug burrow. They put their little noses in the corner, and they breathe into this little corner, and they retain their moisture that way. And some tortoises will, see, they're snugging up in this place, and then they make kind of a berm, and then there's just a little bit of an air slot above them. And they're in this little teeny snug place, and they've got their little noses in the corner, and they're 40 degrees. And then they're just going to stay there till spring, and they're not going to lose much moisture or much else. Pretty neat system, isn't it? Now, oh, I already said what happens if it brumates inside. Sometimes people are moving, or a burrow floods, or something happens that you can't keep your tortoise outside. And you can keep them in a box in the garage, or maybe a double box. And we have instructions for that on our website. You can keep it cool up off the cement a little bit, so that it's insulated from the cement floor in a couple of boxes and loosely covered, and it'll be good in there. You can have a thermometer out there to see what the temperature is. It's not ideal, but it's okay. Better than in the house. Only your tortoise knows how long it will brumate, and it'll make that decision for you. Now, outside the natural range, which is the Mojave Desert, we have a lot of tortoises. We were just talking to a board member who's in Ely, and she said there are all kinds of people up there who have desert tortoises. It's pretty cold in Ely, and we have a lot in Reno, and of course they're in San Diego. And so they do it a little bit differently, especially in the colder climates. It's a whole different deal, because they have to have their tortoise inside during the winter, because obviously it's going to freeze there, and then it'd freeze those little critters right up. So in the in-between season, they have this radically changing temperature. So it gets cold, and then it gets warm, and then it goes like that. So when it gets really cold, they bring their tortoise inside and put it in this special box. And then, oh, the next day it'll be 80, so they take it back out. And this goes on for several weeks, spring and fall, until they actually either go into brumation or come out. Now, if your tortoise is sick or kind of drippy, you have to make a decision about whether it's really safe for it to go into brumation. If it's got a really drooly nose, you probably want to take it to the vet and have the vet make that decision. Sometimes tortoises just have a little bit of dampness on the nose. My tortoise has had this. Now, this isn't a vet talking, so this is just my personal experience. But it's been that. A tortoise can go into brumation, it comes out, it's all nice and dried up. And lots of people have said this, so who knows what happens. Maybe it kills the germs for a while. But of course, the tortoises that carry upper respiratory disease carry it for life. But if your tortoise seems sick, really sick, take it to the vet. And if it's going in and out of the burrow during the winter when it's cold, I'd be worried. I'd think something was wrong with it, and I would want to take it to the vet then, too. Kind of thing that you need to keep an eye on and think about. Now, that was brumation for tortoises. This is the part called brumation for custodians. That's you guys. So you have a well-insulated burrow. It's dry, it's snug. Your tortoise is well, it's well-fed and well-hydrated. So why are you such a wreck all winter? All winter long, out there looking in the burrow, what's wrong? Is my tortoise okay? I'm going to do my famous imitation of custodians in winter. And then the other, the spouse that's holding the umbrella. Uh-huh, we all know about that. So here are some things that you can do so that hopefully you won't worry so much all winter. When it rains, you can put a tarp over the burrow. This is my burrow. And sometimes I think of that and sometimes I don't. And of course, plenty of times I get up in the middle of the night and put it on and then the rain stops. You know how that goes. It's really not all that bad for the burrow to get wet, but I always think it's nicer if it doesn't because I don't want it to get saturated. Now, this year we hear it's a La Nina. You would know, Derek, is it? It's an El Nino. He's a real live meteorologist who can tell us about the weather. So if it's going to rain, and if it's going to rain like it has been the last couple of days, those burrows are going to get saturated, and then there's the chance that it could actually go through into the place where the tortoise is. And you sure don't want your tortoise to get wet because then it could become sick. So you can cover it, but then remember to take the cover off. There's a chair over here. Now, sometimes, even in the middle of winter, a tortoise might wake up because, of course, it's raining and it's natural for them to come out when it rains. That's their strategy for survival. So just watch them, don't feed them, and make sure they get back into the burrow. It's really something to see that cold ice cube walking around out there in the rain. How many of you have seen your tortoise out in the rain in the middle of winter? That's really something. Now, when it's cold and windy in January, I get lots of calls, what am I going to do? Do I need to bring my tortoise inside? And the answer is no. Your tortoise needs to be cold. But if it's really windy and really cold, and I suppose we could have a really, really cold snap, you could do what I did here. I kind of wadded up some paper and I put some masking tape around it so it would kind of make a football, and I stuck it in there. And there's still air circulation. If the tortoise wanted to come out, it could push that out. And then as soon as the windy weather was over and the cold, I took it out again because I want it to stay cold in there. with my handy-dandy infrared thermometer today, I took the temperature in my burrow, and it was 75. Warmer than outside. Oh, we're getting to that in a minute. There. There we are. So there it is, 75 in my burrow. And you know why? Because the temperature of the Earth is last week's temperature, which was a whole lot warmer, and it's going to take a long time for that Earth to cool down. Not really a long time, but a while. So one of the fun things you can do is measure the temperature and hope that it's between 35 and 50, but last year it wasn't. I kept measuring it and it'd be 52 and 55, and so really a little bit warmer than is ideal for tortoise brumation. Now, tortoises need to be cold so that they're in that real brumation. And you know, we want to protect them because they're our babies, right? But resist that temptation to bring them in and put a blankie around them and put them in front of the fire. You know? Well, you know, it's kind of hard to think of them out there. It's just not, it's not in our regular thinking that this is what we do for little critters that we love. Now, it also gets warm and sunny. And if it does that in late January or February, the tortoise might come out again, stomp around a little bit. But remember, they're still brumating, and they're not really going to be done until probably March or April. So just watch them. Don't feed them. And just enjoy. Now, here's a good one. What if I never see my tortoise move? Could it be dead? Well, you don't see it moving, and there's really no reason to think that it's dead, but you can poke it. Get something long and just snake it down there and poke the tortoise in the foot, and it'll just move, and then you'll feel okay. How many people have done that? See? Lots. Yours are inside. You don't need to do that.
Well, ours is 2 and 3 years old.
But ours are 8 feet away or 6 feet away, and then you don't even see them moving in there because they're just this rock. So then it's very different. Yes, Diane.
Last year, just before, you had mentioned that sometimes they wake up in January and February and they'll walk around. Well, I had seen her do that, and then I saw her go back into her burrow, and I checked on her next day, and all of her arms and legs were straight out. I was so scared. Immediately went into the shed, got the poke thing, and poked her, and she was fine. But her arms and legs were straight out. It scared me.
So you thought she was stiff with rigor mortis, huh? And instead, there she was, just relaxed, doing that thing that tortoises do. Oh, how cute. Oh, that's adorable. So these are strategies, hopefully, that'll help you not worry all winter about your tortoise. You're going to worry anyway, right? Hopefully not. Keep the habitat safe. Pick up all that stuff that blows in the wind so it doesn't go into the burrow opening and clutter it up, because then it's tough to get out. There he goes. A day to remember. So mark that last day. It was October 26th for me last year, which was a couple of weeks early. So who knows what'll happen this year. And then in the spring, it's the opposite. Everything is just the opposite from the way it was in fall. But here's a good way to know if your tortoise has come out. Put these little Q-tips up here, and as soon as somebody comes barreling across there and they're knocked down, well, you're not going to be home when it happens, and then you don't know, and that's so much fun, and you're so eager to see your tortoise. So in spring, that's one way to know if your tortoise has come out. So then everything else happens. They start coming out, you want to soak them, and so on. And then we'll meet again in spring. So that's my talk for today. Are there any questions? Yes.
Well, me and his tortoises are 3 and 2. So ours isn't as big as yours. Should we make like a big burrow?
Because we'll help you with that. But they used to be little. He was born at my house. So he was that big then. So they all grow up from little guys. So we'll help you with that. I think, are your folks here?
Yes.
Do you have parents here?
No.
Nobody's claiming you. So Sarah's right behind you there, and she can help you with that. We have a lost and found on our website. I love that.
Next to my parents gave me my brother the tortoises.
They did. What they didn't realize is that you now have two tortoises, and that's going to cause a problem.
Yeah, if they're
boys,
they'll
fight. Uh-huh, and if they're a boy and a girl, they'll have babies, and
I don't find anything wrong with that.
We have
possibilities.
Okay, lads. Let me just say that our overbreeding problem is huge, and we're trying to cut that down, as we all know. Any other questions? Yes, Ed.
Did you take a look at those two little ones?
I did, and they're adorable.
Why does one have rectangular pieces in his shell, and the other one is a regular one?
Because he was born that way.
It's not a different kind of a tortoise.
What level tortoise is this?
Well, these two little guys, you can, in case you forgot how absolutely adorable they are, these two are look different. They have slightly different scutes, of the shapes of the scutes, but that's just the way tortoises are. They're all different. Some of them have a little anomalies. What? A couple of weeks, I guess.
End of July,
that's early. End of August? Well, they haven't grown much. Well, they're this season's guys. And lovely Marilyn brought these for us, thinking we could take them. But you all know that Tortoise Group cannot take in tortoises. And somebody actually found these, and Marilyn thought possibly we could take them. So she's going to take them back to this person. And we'll help them create a habitat for these little guys. They're awfully adorable.
Yeah.
Because I know where there's two more.
My friend's just died, so and she feels so bad.
She has another friend who has another tortoise. There are a gazillion of them, so we can certainly hook you up with one.
Oh, yeah.
You do know that it is not legal for us, however, to adopt small tortoises. A tortoise, for us to adopt a tortoise by law, it has to be at least 4 inches. Well, by regulation of Fish and Wildlife, it has to be 4 inches. And these are not.
Yes.
Hi, y'all, hello. Not mine to say. Yes, Derek.
What is the state of the shelter? I know you guys were building it during the summer. We didn't have a chance to go help you guys out.
Oh, it is. And didn't you see the picture in the newsletter? Do we have a picture in this newsletter? I'm not sure. I'll show you the pictures. Our shelter, as we were calling it, our temporary holding facility has been finished. We finished it right away in April. And we've had tortoises there that have been coming and going to different facilities. And it's an emergency holding facility. So it isn't a place where we take in tortoises from the public because we're not allowed to do that. But emergency cases. And we have tortoises that were left over from the Desert Tortoise Conservation Center that were there. And we're adopting those. And we ended up with a couple from the Animal Foundation. And luckily, there is a place to put a few. There are 20 pens, and I believe it's, do we have 12, Sarah, there? You think 12? I think we have a lady who's moving. Now, here's a thought. There's a lady who's moving. We adopted a tortoise to her. She's moving to another city close by, and the house isn't going to be finished. And she said, could you take my tortoise there while in between? And we thought, maybe. Maybe we could do that.
For a small fee.
For a generous donation, yes. We thought that would be nice. Yeah. So we'll see. It's not exactly an emergency, but it's not taking in a tortoise either. Yes?
I was going to ask you.
You know what? I'm having a little trouble.
If somebody needs a babysitter for a turtle, are they any babysitters that would take care of a turtle for, you know, somebody that is going away someplace and needs a babysitter?
Oh, a babysitter?
Yes.
We used to have a tortoise sitter, but I don't know of anybody now. Usually people ask their neighbor, and if the tortoise is outside, you know, it's if you've built your habitat with browsing and so on, it's good for a week on its own. You might want to have someone check, make sure it's okay, and maybe feed it, but you know it would be okay. But not the same as being there. I actually don't know anybody right now who does that. If somebody's interested in doing that, we ought to collect some names so that we could let people know. Anyone else? Well, then we'll break. It's 10 to 2. And when we come back, this gentleman, Dr. Todd Esque, is with us. And I just want to, I don't want you to leave. Todd Esque is the most wonderful friend of Tortoise Group. And how long have I known you, Todd? 25 years?
At least. Yeah.
He was four. This young lad over at the other museum, oh gosh. And he has been the most wonderful supporter of Tortoise Group, coming, speaking to us, offering his staff to speak to us, which is also very nice. But gosh, just let me tell you what happened just last month. And one of his staff members, Felicia Chen, we'd worked together with some hatchlings, and I asked her if she would help us at our microchipping clinic because we were desperate for people to do the health assessments. And she said, oh, sure. So I copied Todd on that message so he would know what's going on. He emailed me and said, well, I'll do that too. And so the boss comes along too, and he and Felicia were two of our three health assessors, and that's just the kind of guy he is. So I hope you'll stay around for his talk today, which he told me would be very brief. I think it's going to be, that's what tortoises do in winter. That's a joke, because Todd is just full of information. If you look at any tortoise books, you see Todd's name all over the place. And so we're looking forward to seeing him after some refreshments. So we'll see you back at 2:05.
Dr. Todd Esque is a research ecologist with the United States Geological Survey. He has been studying wild tortoises since 1980. He's got a Bachelor of Arts from Prescott College in Arizona, and Man, this list is long. I don't want to embarrass Todd. Okay. And he's mentoring several graduate students right now. So, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to introduce Dr. Todd Esque.
Thanks, Gordon. You got the thing?
Yep. Okay.
If you push in the center, you get...
Got one.
This
got the pointer. Okay, great. Okay, I've thought a lot about tortoises in the winter, it turns out, because I've been doing this since, like I said, like somebody said, 1980. And what goes on, they spend a lot of time down in the winter is what people thought. And for a long time, we figured, well, they're kind of like a frozen turkey. They're just sitting there all bound up, except they're not frozen. But as computers and technology have progressed, we've acquired tools to be able to understand and study tortoises in the wild to a much greater extent. And so I'll show you a little bit about that, and then show you what we learned about what's going on with tortoises in the winter. And I only have about 15 slides. I usually try to have a lot of really nice photographs of the work that we do, but I thought, how many pictures do you guys want to see of tortoises sleeping in the back of a dark burrow? So. Anyway, these were slapped together pretty quickly because we're starting a new project I'll show you about in a minute. But so they're not really much like a frozen turkey. They actually are way more dynamic than that. And this work gets done with some of the grad students that this guy, Dr. Ken Nussier, that works with me, that a lot of people here have met. We have students like Christina Aiello and Christina Drake who are working on desert tortoise ecology, and they'll probably come in here and talk to you about it sometime. So normally I would have blacked that out so you could see better, but 3 hours ago that's where I was, and I have 24 people walking around in that landscape that you can see right now. And so I want to put it in perspective of where we are with tortoises. Right now, tortoises are not down for the winter out in the desert. They're very active. You would not guess that in a few weeks they'll all be somewhere in a cave, pretty well settled in for the winter. But right now, they're running around like crazy. And with the rain, every time it sprinkles out there, there's tortoises all over that landscape coming out from under rocks to get a drink. And yesterday morning, we were just coming onto this plot. There's all these people are lining up on the edges of the plot. They're going to do an elbow-to-elbow search across this whole area. It's a square kilometer. And somebody right off the bat found a tortoise just like these little guys that were in the box. And the little guy was pulled up against a rock, getting the water that ran off the rock and getting a drink through his nose. And it was just so wonderful to see that happening for wild tortoises, because as a lot of you know, they're a threatened species because they're not doing that great out in the desert in general. But the work that we're finding in places like this is indicating that there's a few places where we're doing pretty well. This is in, if you know where El Dorado Dry Lake is out by Boulder City, and you know where all the power lines go and push through the mountains out on the west, it's McCullough Pass. So all the power lines are put right through this spot right here. And we've been asked to study how the tortoises are doing in places like that. For one thing, if you've been around a while and you've read about tortoises, the dogma is that everyone would claim that they're just out in the creosote bush, out in the bottoms of the valleys where it's really flat in the Mojave Desert. And they would argue with you that they don't live in places like this. In fact, I've been in a lot of arguments with people about if you would bother to argue about it, but there's some of us that do, in places like this. And so in this area, we're probably going to come up with an estimate of over 50 in a square kilometer in this area. And everything from the little tiny guys that were born a few weeks ago to ones that are completely smooth and they're like this big. So it's kind of neat. So I'm a little sleep deprived because we've been doing this since last Monday, and we've been going from dawn till dusk hiking out in this country. And this is country that if you're going up, we're going up to the tops of these peaks, and you got to be on all fours to do some of that. So it's a lot of fun. I've never been happier, but if I miss some words or something, just chalk it up to fatigue. Why is hibernation important to wild tortoises? Well, first of all, it's a good way to avoid freezing. So by being in these caves, although it is very cool and I can show exactly what the temperatures are where tortoises live out in the wild, freezing can be lethal. And when you live way up north here, and it's inevitable that at least once in 10 years we're going to get a hard freeze. If it kills the cactus, then it could damage a tortoise too, or palm trees. So they're avoiding, you know, bad inclement weather. Also, when they're cool like that, since they are essentially the same temperature as the outdoors, when they're that cold, it's they move very slowly, so it's difficult to avoid predators. So it's a good time just to stay out of sight, which is what tortoises do most of the time. And besides that, you know, we all read about animals need sleep to be healthy. I mean, it's really important for us, each of us, to sleep on a regular basis and repair our bodies daily. And I wonder, there's no research on this, of course, but I just wonder, you know, maybe tortoises just need a lot of time to repair themselves, you know? And, you know, what is going on in their brains when they're in these states of being very cool? And because they're not just out, as Kathy indicated, and I wanted to say, everything that you said is just spot on as far as I can tell, and it's really neat how it parallels with what we know about wild tortoises. And so if you tap them, they do move, and then if it rains, they come out and get a drink, but we're going to get into that more of the details in a minute. With regard to health, we really don't know much about it, but it's probably pretty important. As many of you know, the wild tortoises suffer from various diseases, including this upper respiratory disease. It's kind of like pneumonia. And we don't know if their immune system shuts all the way off in the winter, and if is that the time when the disease can get a grip on them better or not. But right now, the students that we're working with through the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and different groups are studying to understand you know, what goes on with disease in the winter and things like that. But these are the kind of things that we're working on. Why do we need to know about hibernation and winter activity? It's really important in these areas where we're doing, where a lot of construction is going on, because the Fish and Wildlife Service puts extra precautions out there when there's going to be bulldozers running around, because we actually, you know, mostly they take precautions to not be running over tortoises on these big sites like the solar facilities that you see now. And so from the work that we've done, and I'm going to show you in a little bit here, pretty much from March 15th from November 15th to March 15th is a time when they try to get them to do some of the work more freely out in the desert, because tortoises are really close to their burrows at that time, and it's safer. There's less risk of them being wandering around and getting run over or bulldozed or something like that. And then outside of that time, they take a lot of extra precautions. So the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, they're the ones that make the rules up about these sort of things, like endangered species. And so this kind of information is really important to them. And that's why some of this work got done. So some of the hardware we use is, like, this is a data logger right here. And this is on one side of the tortoise. I had another picture, but it didn't come through, of the transmitter for the radio. So on one side of the tortoise, they get a transmitter that helps us locate them. But this is a GPS recorder that talks to a satellite and records where that tortoise is to within a couple of meters every 15 minutes. And so every month or so, we have to go find the tortoises and download the information off the data logger. And that's how we can get some of this information about how much are they moving around in the winter, too. And so we've done that a few winters ago. We did that sort of work. There's another kind of little device. Let's see here. So your basic tortoise here. So we have another device that helps us understand what temperature is the core temperature of the tortoise. And in order to do that, we had to outfit a tortoise. And I don't have a picture of that. I couldn't find the paper to take the picture out of it. But we took your basic tortoise, and we put little attachments back here by the tail, in the leg pits, in the rear legs, and in the forelimbs, up near the neck, on top of the head. We had a sensor in its mouth and in the cloaca to find out the core temperature, so we could correlate where on the body of the tortoise could you put a sensor that's recording temperature that would approximate its body temperature. So like when we go to the doctor, put a thermometer in your mouth, if you put it on the surface of your skin, it wouldn't be quite as good of an accurate, indication of what your temperature is as it is in your mouth. So we did that work a while back, and we found out that right above the tail, there's the little tip of the tail there. Under the shell, there's a little space, and you probably all know this from looking at your own tortoises. There's just a little bit of a space there, and if you put a sensor right there, it approximates the core temperature most closely of anywhere on their body. So that's what we did. We put these little sensors that we would glue on the back like anything else. The thing about tortoises is you can attach things, and it doesn't really bother them at all. And so we put a little sensor right here with a battery. The battery is the biggest thing of the whole thing. And then a little wire comes underneath, and with a little bit of epoxy, right where the skin meets the shell, we glued that there and got the temperatures. And then we collected information. Well, this is from the GPS, actually. And so we start over here where it's above ground in November. Wait a second. October, above ground. This tortoise had a sensor on it that was walking around out in the desert. And then also still in November, it was above ground. Come down to here to December, this one was above ground. Then it went to a shallow burrow in January. And then by March, it went into a deep burrow. So seasonally, there's a lot of variation on when tortoises, as you were saying, go into brumation. And we did a lot of work to try to figure out what causes them to go down. Is it related to the temperatures of that they're experiencing, or how dry it is, and all different things. And we did not come to a final conclusion of what makes them settle down for the season. There's just huge variation. And it probably depends on how much they've eaten for the summer, how much they got to drink, whether or not there's other tortoises nearby that are bothering them, and all kinds of things like that. But right now, there's a few more questions than there are answers for that sort of thing.
Was this normal, Todd? Because it's like
it's a little off.
What we think of?
It's a little bit off, and I think it was used as actually as an example of how different they can be.
Yeah.
And this is a wild tortoise, so that made it. This is the kind of information that comes off the little sensors that we put on the back by their tail. And so just to explain it, along the bottom here are the dates going from September in 95, the end of September in 1995, to March in 1996, so through the whole winter. And you can see that each one of the little dots that's connected by a line is a temperature. Over here it's in Celsius, but so every hour or so it took a temperature, and in the fall we put these on, and we wanted to know when do the tortoises go down. So we can tell really clearly that here, right at this time, in this case, it was between November 18th and November 25th, this tortoise suddenly stopped going outside, where every time it goes up to these temperatures, up to 45, that's when it's outside in the sun. And then these solid line temperatures are when it's in a pretty stable place, which is underground. So about that time, we would consider, we had some rules we made up about, well, if they're don't vary by more than a few degrees for so many days, then they've started their hibernation. So this one started in the middle of November, and you can see that the temperatures were steadily dropping as it was in this burrow, and then all of a sudden it came out in January. And that's when we didn't know anything about this. We didn't know, sometimes we would find tortoises out in the winter, but we had no idea until we put a dozen of these out, and on this day, all the tortoises came out. And it turns out that it rained that day. And so getting a drink in the desert is so important that you, even when you're hibernating and you look like a frozen turkey, you'll come out and try to get a drink. And it's probably very risky. In fact, we know that it's very risky. Sometimes a badger will find them, or a coyote will find them if they're little. And but nevertheless, it's so important to come out, even though they're going to be very sluggish. And so then they go back in, and they stayed like this for a while. So this is there's a little bit of variation here. You can see this line kind of bumps around, and it varies from about 10 degrees when it's in its burrow. But every burrow is different. So here's one that's a little more stable, a little less bumping around on this. And once it hit hibernation here, on this one was 11/15, so the 15th of November. And then this was a different situation. And 12/13, these weren't all the same, exactly the same place and things like that. So these are the rough estimate. This is the body temperature. So 45 to 65. 45 to 65. I'll go back.
Zero's 32.
Yep. So this one, I wanted to put that there because I know that this has been a point of contention for people. 48 to 61 degrees Fahrenheit is the range of the wild tortoise. So it doesn't mean that it's the right temperature. It just means that this tortoise has probably been doing this for probably some 30 winters and done okay at that temperature. Because they tend to go to the same burrow year after year, or a cave. And the deeper they go with more soil on top, the more stable it is, just like any cave. And so this is kind of more of the same. But this one, as you see, is very different. It's almost a straight line. And this one was from up in Littlefield, Arizona. There's these deep arroyos. They're about 15 or 20 feet deep. And right at the bottom of that, there was a cave that went back, and it went back about 12 feet. So this is a very heavily insulated place. And this tortoise, you know, from a week-to-week basis, it didn't vary more than a degree. So it's a really stable place to be. And then there was a time when it rained, and it came out, and they came out.
How did the body temperature correlate with the air temperature? You know that?
Well, we have the information, but I didn't put that in all these because it didn't matter that much.
Was it
you mean in the cave?
Yeah.
It's about the same.
is it?
Yeah, it's really similar. They really are. They're ectotherms, and so...
48 to 61 maybe is better than 35.
Well... You didn't just make that number up. I'm very aware of that. So I think that the numbers you provided are fine, and these are just individuals too. So there's a huge variability of how tortoises, what temperatures they're at. But you don't want them to get to freezing for sure. And this one was straight line, and it came out a couple times during the winter. But something happened here, and it was disturbed. And this was in January, which is pretty strange actually. So it probably went to a different place because. Or it just came to the entrance and then to the entrance here and then stayed near the entrance, a little bit nearer to the entrance when it went back in. So you can read into this a lot by not even actually seeing the animals, but it's kind of, we were really excited when we were able to get this information. And the whole thing about tortoises drinking in the winter, now there's some guys just now in the Sonoran Desert down by Phoenix that did the same thing that we just did here. And they're all very excited because they're finding out that they're coming out for a drink as well. So tortoises everywhere got to get a drink if they live in deserts. And so now we're going to go to another study where we had at Fort Irwin, which was a few years ago. And at one point we had radios on over 600 tortoises for that project. And we were asked to go help Fort Irwin. They were going to do the work that they do there at Fort Irwin. It's a national training center for the military. And it's force on force training, which is the way they used to do battle in tanks. They would run tanks at each other across big areas. So, you know, the result of that is going to be a lot of flattened ground. So they asked us to translocate those tortoises in a way that would be, first of all, humane for the animals. And second of all, they're going to spend all this money. It was going to cost them a lot. It doesn't go in my pocket, but it does cost a lot to put people on the ground out there that get paid. And they wanted us to make sure we learn something when we do that. So we had a lot of different studies that came out of that. But this is the part where, and almost, people collect this kind of information all the time that I'll show you, but they almost never do anything with it. So we decided, why don't we figure out what's going on? And it turned out that you guys wanted to know about winter behavior. So these are tortoises in the winter and at Fort Irwin. And so this area where they were going to do the tank training was right in here. And this is like it's like 6 kilometers deep that way, and about it looks like about 15 or 20 that way. It's a pretty big area, and so they wanted all the tortoises from this area to be moved down here onto BLM land, and they wanted all the tortoises up here. Well, they thought they wanted to have all the tortoises up here, which was about 600, to be moved down here, but then a new general came and said, "I'm paying for what?" And we were gone like the next day, but so that ended abruptly and sad for us, but probably good for those tortoises because they're not bothering. What happened was the military changed the way they were doing activities, and they're not going to train that way out there anymore. So they really didn't need to destroy that area. It's actually better for the tortoises. So now they build like in little spots out there. They build little little fake cities, and they go through scenarios where they have strange things happen out in the desert. So, but anyway, that doesn't really affect us or the tortoises now. These tortoises were inactive, are the dark ones here, spread all over the desert. December active ones are the red dots, the big red dots. And then we have blue dots are January active. And then February are the white dots. And essentially, it's spread all over the place. So there's, it looks like here that it's just sort of tortoises do whatever tortoises do. And everyone's different, right? Variety. But then, if we take that information and we look at it in a different way, and this is, we won't be very much of this, but because I usually like to use photographs to convey the message. But anyway, but when you added them all up with hundreds of tortoises, we had the active tortoises. There were 250 out of probably about 400 that we had these sensors on in November, and then it dropped down to 50 dramatically in December. Started rising back up, more active, 100 in January, and back up to the same amount as November by February at this location. So so tortoises really do get out and get around. A large number of them do in the winter. So if yours gets up and looks around, it's probably not a bad thing at all. It's just like what tortoises do. Then we tried to understand why. So Kathy was asking, why do they go, why are they active or not in the winter? And it turned out that I'm not going to get into the details. Well, these bars, active is blue. Those are the tortoises that were active out of the whole group. And gray is the ones that weren't active. And the deal is that these two bars are almost the same. They're like within a degree of each other. So there's not very much difference. But it said the results came out as active tortoises had higher average temperatures than inactive ones. So if you got cooler or you were in a place that was cooler, you were less likely to come out of your burrow in the winter. And but the difference was really tiny on this. So it may be just splitting hairs that don't really matter to tortoises on this topic. So that's the thing about the temperature. There we go. Turns out, though, that rainfall in the summer before you go into hibernation was really important. So the tortoises that got a good drink before hibernation started, these are the active ones. This is how much rain they got on this side. So more rain for these guys than these guys in December. More rain for these guys than these guys from the previous summer. And more rain for these guys than these guys. So all through the winter, if you got a good drink in the summer, you didn't have to come out when it was when it rained in the winter. So you were in good shape. If your bladder's full, you can only get so full. So then they didn't need to come out. I think we'll just skip elevation. So this is the little tortoise I was telling you. It was 41 millimeters. We're absolutely amazed. It used to be that people didn't find little tortoises like that when we did these kind of surveys. But there's so much work right now that people are out doing these surveys that they're actually getting really good at it. And so we found at south of Gene out there, we have a plot that I worked on it in 1984, and we had about 25 or 35 tortoises. I haven't gone back and read that study again since we went out there this week. But we had 25 or 35 tortoises we found on a square mile. Well, this week we went out and did a square kilometer within that square mile. We actually found one of the tortoises that I marked in 1984. And it was probably adult then, which means that tortoise has to be probably 50 years old, which is really getting up there for a wild desert tortoises. Because Phil Medica, who's spoken here before, did a study at the Nevada test site where he put little guys like were in that box in a giant pen out at the Nevada test site. And every year for 45 years, he went out and measured them. And it turned out that that's about how long he made it. There was five left just a couple of years ago, and a lion came down out of the hills and got all five tortoises. So that was the end of that study. But they were 45, and we're getting down to the last few. So that's probably on average how long they live around here in the wild. But this guy that we found the other day had to have made it longer than that.
At 45, approximately how large was the tortoise?
That varies too, depending on where they are, if it's a really good site or not such a good site. But in southern Nevada, the biggest ones we've seen are about 320 millimeters, so they're about this big. They're really pretty big. And
45, roughly 2 feet.
Probably more like 18 inches.
Okay.
Yeah.
A wild tortoise, 18 inches?
That's big.
Wow.
I didn't do the conversion. Maybe they're a little smaller than that. Yeah. The big ones are like that, and so the study that we're doing is to find out how many little ones and how many big ones are they, and how's the population doing? Are they? What's essentially happened at the Sheep Mountain plot, which is by Gene, is that since I studied there and marked tortoises, there was somebody that did it before me, 5 years before me out there. I don't think there's any left from when she did it, but there's been almost 100% turnover, which is really interesting because, you know, tortoises, they get really old and then they die. And then what's happening across the desert is that they're not replacing themselves. And that's when we have a population problem, and that's why they're on the threatened species list. So the studies that we're doing out there at this site, they actually did something different, which is all the old ones are gone that were there 30 years ago when I was there. But there's a whole lot of new ones. And they're all about this big, about 180 millimeters, and that's when they start breeding again. And there was a whole lot of them out there. So, I mean, there was like 20 in the square kilometer. So that means that the population is actually appears to be doing pretty well there, which is really exciting.
Again, we have two, and they're both male, and we're fairly new to this. We're trying to get an idea just about the age. Everything we've looked at online is it's very difficult to tell tortoise's age in general. We come to understand that. But one of our males is slightly about maybe 3% larger than the largest one on the table. and our other male is about half that size. So what do we think? The large one is what, 15 to 20 year old, or is it maybe 12 to 15?
It could be 20.
Huh?
It could be 20, but in captivity they grow a lot faster. So if it was always raised on food at home and they get fed every day, then they can get that big in a really short time. Like, you would know better than I do.
Way too fast.
Like 5 or 6 years? Yeah. So it only takes a few years. But in the wild, they may go 1 or 2 years without having really a bite to eat.
Any noticeable size difference?
What's
they
that?
May go a couple of years without any noticeable.
Oh, then they don't grow at all. Yeah, they just don't grow. Yeah. But then if we get a year, like if it's an El Nino this spring, and there's food everywhere, and that's when we get very excited thinking about that, because those are the kind of years which are, it's, you know, 1 in 10 years, maybe 1 in 20 years, do we see that. And the thing about that kind of a year is that there's good food, so there's a lot of eggs. And then if we get summer rains, the little guys make it. And then if there's 2 years in a row like that, it could be that the young ones can get through that next year and get started. And that's probably what happened out there from way back in either 1983 or 1992 and 93. Those were years at the end of really big rainfall. 92, 93 were really big rainfall. And that's probably when a bunch of tortoises makes it. Because most of the time, they probably, the little guys, it's just so hard out there, a lot of them don't make it. I mean, they just, there's nothing to eat. Like Kathy was saying, they're way more sensitive to the variability that's out there than the big ones, who can make it a couple of years without food. I mean, that's all I had, I think. So
thanks
for letting me talk about that.
To paraphrase a Mel Brooks movie, a Laurel and Hardy thank you. Okay, let's see. If we could go to that last slide, JC. The one that... Any one of them will do. That's fine. Just get a nice picture. Go to the last one. Voila, there we go. Okay, this is going to be our last meeting of the year, and our next meeting is scheduled for March of next year. In the meantime, our website has all sorts of information, and we welcome everybody to come on the website. I'm available for questions afterwards. Kathy is available. Sarah is available as well. Oh, yes, yes, yes. I'm so glad you're sitting there, Kathy. on November 15th, and a lot of you folks in here probably have already received the RSVP for it, we're having our volunteer appreciation event. And it is at the Nevada State Museum. And if you've already received the RSVP, please click on the RSVP button so we know how many folks are coming, okay? And that goes November 15th, that's a Sunday, from 3 to 5 in the afternoon. We're also having, I'm drawing a complete blank here, that's it for the rest of the year. Oh, are you talking about the happy hours? Or? Yeah, well, we're going to start, and I don't know if we're going to start it in December, and we may have to wait until January to do this. Once a month, we're going to do a happy hour. We're going to find a place around town. Could be on the north side, could be Summerlin, could be Henderson. It's going to be some place that agrees to host us for free. That's the bottom line. But it'll be basically just get together. I'll use a restaurant like Chili's for an example. I'm just pulling something out. But we'll let you guys know when it is, and it'll be a happy hour. It'll be like 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and it'll be just a social gathering, essentially. And we invite everybody to bring somebody new to that has not been to a Tortoise Group meeting. It's a different setting. You know, it'll be in a bar or in a kind of a restaurant atmosphere. But the whole idea is basically just to have a social gathering and a different atmosphere to talk about tortoise. Is that the tortoises? Okay, anybody got any questions? Was there a question? Thank you guys for coming. Have an awesome brumation, and we'll see you next March.